stock? Yes, as a matter of fact. Page number one. Yes, I see you.
My name is Octavia Logan. I'm the facility coordinator for the Dallas. Four members here tonight. Do you mind if I introduce them?
Oh, please, absolutely.
Well, ladies first, we have Ms. Liz Wally.
Hey, Liz.
All of us are working in the Dallas area, so if you know some of these people that want to get involved, hit them up. They're more than happy to help out, and they're more than willing to get you in contact with them.
Absolutely. And here's the other thing I want to let y'all know, that by being an affiliate of Move2Men, to be an affiliate of Move2Men simply requires that you say, we are in agreement for a constitutional amendment to abolish all corporate constitutional rights and money is not speech. And we may be committed to an anti-oppression organizing framework, right? And then we make so many tools available. We have, and you have the ability to actually get in touch with everybody who is in our list. And there are thousands of people in the Dallas area, right? So we will make these tools available to all of you that are coming together. We just need to organize ourselves. We are already winning. We just need to get ourselves a little better organized. So thank you, Octavia, for that. And for the four of you who are there, Sam, are y'all meeting on a regular basis yet?
We have been, but it's...
Who here would like to actually get involved with these folks? Do we have anybody? All right, so here's the thing. What I'm going to ask those of you who are willing to, y'all should get together at the end of this discussion period and figure out a time to get together, right, and really reinvigorate this. Because I know that y'all got started pretty early, right?
Two or three months ago.
Okay. With 160 of them, look, I'm not looking for a pat on the head. I'm on the road between one half and two-thirds of my life, right? I'm in it to win, right? I've dedicated myself to this proposition. Thank you, sir. I've dedicated myself to this very proposition, and so I don't keep up with everything, but we have an entire campaign of folks. And let's see, which one is this? Yeah, this guy. Thank you, sir, for that.
Wait,
this? Number two. Yes, sir.
Besides the problem that we have that you're working at, I think we have the best Congress money can buy. That's our biggest problem. The corporations control the Congress, and we have congressmen fighting for donations. They're not listening to us, they're listening to the corporation. They're listening to people who are buying their vote. That's what has to change. And one of the things that should be done, in my opinion anyway, is get Congress to act in its own self-interest to instruct the Federal Communications Commission to require the media to provide sufficient free airtime for federal candidates in general elections. There are their views, the last 90 days of elections.
Sure.
That would change everything.
Here's the thing. The problem is that law would probably be deemed unconstitutional because it violates the corporate constitutional rights.
Well, then we have to do what you say.
That's right. And so all I'm getting at is, I agree with what you're saying. Yeah. It's not either or, it's both and.
Cool.
And Ruthie, would you make sure that everybody gets either one of those brochures and or one of those postcards so people can see the constitutional amendment that's out there? Fantastic. So, I'm sorry, you had another point?
If I want to go one step further.
Sure.
Some other laws that need to be changed. It can't be changed until we change the corporate, until we change the money structure in Congress. Is that as the corporations have gone overseas where labor costs are cheaper, we need to put tariffs on corporations, not put tariffs on other countries. Because when you put a tariff in another country, you have a price wage battle. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you put it on a corporation, you don't. And I think that because they're going where labor costs are cheaper, that's why we've lost so much in this country. That's part of the problem. The corporations are ruling the world, not just our country.
There's no doubt about that.
And then the third thing is, since the Industrial Revolution, machines replace people, and machines don't pay taxes. People pay taxes. That's why we have 25 million people out of work right now. Part of why. And I think we need to shorten the workday in this country without cutting the pay. But that won't happen until we change these other things. So, anyway.
All right, thank you. Number three. Yes, sir.
I was just curious, do you see Move2Men intersecting with any other groups, like, say, Common Ground, Robert Rice's
Well, as a matter of fact, move to amend reports. We're creating, well, first of all, let me just say that we have decided not to hate the media, but to become the media. And behind the scenes right now is Bucky. Hey, Bucky. Mm. The thing is, if you're watching me right now, it's because Bucky decided that he didn't just hate the media, he was going to become the media, so we're creating our own media, like Bucky's doing. Yeah. And one of the things that Move to Amend has done is to create Move to Amend Report. I'm happy to say we had Robert Reich as a guest, and you can download that at Move to Amend. So we actually positively do engage with other groups. Again, we're willing to work with any group that we can actually find some common ground with, and we're going to continue to do so. So but that's a very long way of saying yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's one of his groups, common ground, that's on the board, but I think it's seems like its goals intersect very
they good. Are, but one of the things that I will say this, and I say this with humility, but also sincerity. One of the problems, in my estimation, is that these big D.C.-based groups have kind of created this nonprofit industrial complex where they have forgotten that it takes movements in the streets to actually make significant change.
Yeah.
I think that that's a real problem. One of the things that Move to Amend has actually done is we have put our resources into local organizing and empowering people at the local level. I don't actually expect to negotiate with power. I don't even want to actually speak truth to power. I'm going to speak truth about power. And I'm going to build power with people, and we're going to exercise it together in a way that transforms. I don't think, no systemic transformational movement has ever actually been provoked, nurtured, or led out of Washington, D.C. Think about it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? The labor movement didn't start in D.C., right? And honestly, it's worth pointing out that it was workers on the line that created the sit-down strike. It was workers on the line that actually began the process known as collective bargaining. It was workers on the line that actually devised the strategies. And honestly, it's not just the labor movement. During the civil rights movement, it was actually ordinary people, like Rosa Parks, by the way. Who's Rosa Parks? Montgomery Boycott. Here's the question. Was Rosa Parks just tired one day?
No.
No, Rosa Parks was trained at the Highlander Folk School, right?
Oh.
But she was part of a grassroots movement, right? And by the way, the Greensboro sit-down diners, right? They were actually not led by anyone except themselves. They were looking for how they plug in. The civil rights movement had a great line. Get in where you fit in, right? And we need to start thinking that way, too. And here's my honest thing. If Move to Amend doesn't, obviously I got fire in the belly, right? Because I believe we need a democracy movement. This makes a lot of sense to me, right? But honestly, if there's some other movement or some other issue that draws you, right, and you just want to stay there, then that's fine, right? No problem. We want to collaborate with you. We want to coordinate with you. But I do think this, one of the things that makes Move to Amend growing in a way that no other group is going is that we're empowering people. In Dallas, y'all have access to the entire database in Dallas, right? The folks at, what's the database that we use? Nation Builder. The folks at Nation Builder, I was actually at a symposium. I was there to do a workshop later. They didn't know who I was. I'm not famous, right? So I was in the crowd, and the workshop presenter in front of me was from Nation Builder. They were talking about their tool, and they said, and you can do amazing things. There's this group called Move to Amend that are actually, they're just giving the access, and they're growing faster than any other customer that we've ever had because they're actually trusting their membership to actually use the tool. And I was like, So what number were you, sir?
Three.
Number four.
Hey, so I have a very quick question. People in China have been pretty outraged the fact that the leaders have air purifiers in their homes and they don't. And I'm kind of outraged that the 1% are protected behind their gated communities and their guards. I would just like for you to maybe just give us a little bit of a feel for what you think is the end game for all what's going on now around the world.
Sure.
Wealth inequality and all these things.
Yeah, look, I think the 1% end game, they literally believe that they can build walls big enough, engage communities big enough, that they can actually keep us out. That's, I think, and when you say end game, all right, I'm gonna address that full on. I think we're headed for revolution. And I think that the real end game comes when are we so well organized and that we're taking over in every way, and that when the ruling elite call on the military and the police to lock us up and shoot at us, that they won't do it because they're neighbors, that they're fellow countrymen. They're us, right? Because here's something else that I bet my sister in the labor movement knows. You know what police officers are? What do you think they are? Workers. They're workers.
Union.
Oh, is that right? They're workers. And so here's the thing. I'm not saying that they're all, like, you know, angels, but I don't think they're all demons either. So here's the thing. If you want to, like, if you want to know what I think the end game really is, there's a fellow named Gene Sharp. Look him up. Gene Sharp, who has actually written 117 ways to do nonviolent revolution. He is considered by many, oh, you know him, Bucky. He's considered to be the leading expert today on nonviolent revolutionary theory and practice. I think we're headed for a revolution in this country, and I think that we need to embrace that, but that's also why we need to commit ourselves with the discipline that King did, that Gandhi did, to nonviolence. Because let me tell you something, I'm a believer in nonviolent revolution for two reasons. Number one is a spiritual, moral, ethical one. I don't think you create a peaceful, just society violently, right? As my mama taught me, the means can never justify the ends can never justify the means, because the means are the ends in the making. How you conduct yourself is how you're going to actually be, right? So there is a very moral, ethical, principled position for nonviolence. There's also a very practical, tactical one. They will kill us. The idea of violent revolution is over, my friend. The level of surveillance that is capable today, the level of violence that they have, it's not like they're willing to do violence in a way that they weren't before. The ruling elite have always been willing to do violence. How many of you know that Tulsa, Oklahoma was air bombed? A couple of people, right? Right? Why? Because they say a race riot, actually because there was a police riot, African Americans defended themselves. Tulsa in the 1910s and the 1920s was actually considered Black Wall Street.
Yeah.
And it was bombed. Right? So what I'm saying is that, like, the elites have always been willing to use violence if they can in any way justify it. However, if you take a look at the civil rights movement, if you take a look at how Gandhi actually defeated the largest empire the world had ever seen, nonviolence works. I like how Cesar Chavez said it, which I think was very profound. He said, nonviolence is not passivity. Nonviolence is not for the weak. In fact, only the strong can do nonviolence, because nonviolence is a dedication and the courage to win.
Yeah. Hey.
Right?
Amen.
And I am in no way going to personally compare myself to Gandhi or King or Chavez, but I'll tell you this, we're going to learn from them. Right? And we're going to apply these same techniques and tools. So that, my sir, is my end game. Number five.
I'm number five.
Yes, sir.
I've been involved in the local Move to Amend for several months since it was started. And the conference calls and looking at some of the documentation, there's an air of dogmatism, of being dogmatic, and there's no enforcement mechanism. So it's not like you're precluded from thinking on your own. But in a sense, it's a set of talking points where everyone nods in agreement, which surprises me. And there's some odd things that come up, like nature should have rights. That was in the second, which is just stupid. But everyone agrees that, of course, that's true. And would you comment on that, particularly in the context of your definition of rights?
Absolutely. I would muster as much love and compassion when I say I find it incredibly insulting how you just asked that question and that you think that it's stupid that nature has rights. And I'll go you one better.
Great.
I think you were insulting indigenous people and people throughout the world who have understood that the natural world has always had rights. The fact that our limited understanding of law and rights cannot comprehend reality is our cultural problem. And the way that you said it, I disagree with you profoundly. I think nature does have rights. We just don't have a legal system that's capable of acknowledging it. And here's something else. You know that there is actually a constitution that codifies and recognizes rights today? It's in Ecuador.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And in Bolivia, where Evo Morales, an indigenous person, the first indigenous person, by the way, to get elected president of Bolivia, is actually in a process of rewriting their constitution as well. So when you say, nature does have rights. Now, trees don't have the same rights as human beings because trees have tree rights, right? You know, raccoons have raccoon rights. So, with all due respect, I think that your understanding is very narrow and limited, and rather than ask a question, you popped off with
I've asked several questions on the list, and the answers are rather uniform and they're not explanatory.
Did my best to explain.
Right. So corporations don't have rights, but a volcano does, or a tree does. Seems bizarre. Just bizarre.
Well, I mean, you know.
It's a cultural shift.
It's a
paradigm.
I mean,
we've been sold on rights that are fictitious.
Right. And here's the other thing, I absolutely agree with that.
It just seems like an odd construct to get the point across.
Are you just worried?
You really haven't explained. I'm kind of naive, so I would appreciate you really explaining what you mean when you say a tree has rights. And I am honestly being naive.
Okay, so I would tell you is this, that when you talk about rights, you're talking about the ability to exist and not to have your rights taken away.
Right.
There is a different legal framework. It's a complete cultural shift in how it is. Now, this gentleman is nowhere on Move to Amend does our proposed amendment call for that. We're simply calling for a conversation to begin, right? I'm not, and you'll notice I did in my entire presentation. Go ahead.
I'm still trying to clarify.
So we have a.
Are you saying that a tree has rights, so that a tree must never be cut down?
Of course not.
You have the tree's permission. That's what I'm trying to understand.
The answer is
no.
So I mean, look. I'm going to ask. We have a stack. If you can help be very clear, Donnie, I'll give you an opportunity to try to clear this up.
You're going to have to do a little bit of reading. There's one book called The Primal Mind by Jampi Highwater. It discusses a different way of thinking than how you've been brought up to think. To understand the primal mind are people who are First Nation people who live with nature. The other is Daniel Quinn. Any of his books, Ishmael, The Story of Bee, will give you a concept of a different way of looking at the world. Because you're trained to think in a certain way. And what I believe he's trying to say is that there's a different way of thinking, and you're just going to take a little bit of reading and research on your part to discover a new way of thinking.
And at the end of the day, I want to remind you again, look at Move to Amend's proposed amendment. It's not in there. Our amendment is very explicit and clear. However, we do think that there is a movement that goes way beyond just corporate constitution rights and money of speech. And we ought to be open to thinking about and having these kinds of conversations. That's all. And in your local group, you should do it. We also are pretty clear, though, that we have to have conversations about the history of whiteness and how white supremacy has been used, right? There's all sorts of things that have to be part of the conversation that have not been part of the conversation. And I want to point out the fact that we're able to do it, and I don't want to sort of call you out, sister, but I can't help but to notice that when you heard nature having rights, you started to applaud, right? I think it's important to point out that everywhere that I go, young people are so quick and easy around intersectionality. They're so quick and easy around the new thinking. There is something happening now, and I'm not even going to pretend for one moment that I'm at the cutting edge of it. I'm working hard to keep up with it. right? And I want to be participatory and part of it. That's all. So who's not? Did you have a follow-up? Because who's number six? Yes, sir.
A lot of times when these issues are brought up, and the elite will start screaming class warfare. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I heard a quote describes the real situation, and they said the example of real class warfare in the U.S. is Fox News.
Yeah.
It's the super rich Murdoch paying the wealthy and the back, et cetera, to tell the middle class, us, to hate the poor.
Yeah.
No, that's right. Yeah, there's a couple of things. Warren Buffett, actually, he was asked about that. And he said, of course there's a class war, and my class is winning.
Yeah.
Right? And yeah. there's a great joke that I saw going around that I thought was really telling. It's like, imagine that there is a pie, and it's cut into 12 slices, and there's organized labor on one side, there's the working poor on the other, there's skilled craftsmen, there's all the different segments of the people who actually produce the pie, and then the 1% comes in, grabs 11 of them, cuts the 12th one in half, takes all of that, and then says, watch out, that organized labor, he's going to steal your half of the slice of pie, right? That's what they're doing to us.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So you've done dozens of meetings, and I was just wondering about if this is typical demographics, and if it is, where are the young people, the minorities?
Well, I guess I would tell you this, that when I'm on college campuses, it's a much, much, much younger crowd, right? That's just the reality. When I am invited to speak at a black church, it is mostly black. It's a function usually of how the organizing has been done. The other thing I want to be very clear about is that, honestly, the progressive community in this country, not just in Dallas, Texas, but in this country, has done a pitiful, pathetic job of actually doing real work around class analysis and around gender and around race. Mm. And part of what we're doing in Move to Mend is creating a curriculum to do that. And the thing is, not because it's just because it's the right thing to do. It is the right thing to do on a route of moral and ethics. It's because we have to do it to win. Because here's something else. I got news for you, white folks. We are no longer going to be a majority if we are. I'm not sure if it's already happened, right? I think that it may have been. Okay. So this is the thing. And you know what? I'm not scared of it. I'm not scared of people of color, nor am I scared of the power of people of color, because I actually understand the shared humanity. I really do. You know, and I think that what we've got to do is do the work of understanding exploitation and oppression historically. And white folks have got to actually be willing to have candid conversation about unearned privileges that have been associated with whiteness and have honest conversation around it. Because I'll tell you something, I've never had anybody tell me, oh, thank you for being guilty. Yeah. You know, thanks for that white liberal guilt. I've never had that, right? But what I have had is appreciation for candid conversation about white skin privilege. I've had conversations like that. And what I'm proud to tell you that Move to Mend, look, Move to Mend's national leadership team, there are 11 of us. You're looking at the only white man. That didn't just happen, right? That was because of intentional, deliberate work that we've done in terms of reaching out and doing building and working with. And so your question is a fair one, right? Looking around at this crowd, especially around age, and around skin color and pigmentation and ethnicity. And what I'm telling you is this. I think that when we start to do the work around intersectionality, it'll give us a language to be able to go in to other communities and have honest conversations. And at the end of the day, I think that the problem has been that, you know, as King said, during the height of the civil rights movement, the most segregated day of the week in the United States?
Sunday.
Right? Because we haven't actually done that work. And so we're beginning to do that work. That's all I would say. And, you know, Move to Mend is growing. and the education curriculum that we're starting to do around. Has anybody done any of the education curriculum yet? We got one person. You've started. What's been your experience?
I told you my one reaction to one piece of it.
Cool. That wasn't even part that wasn't part of the education curriculum. What you just said.
Well, it's
not. I mean, you may have found that on the website, which is a pretty expensive website, but the readings had nothing to do with that.
Is that the talking about white privilege?
Yes.
I felt uncomfortable, to be honest with you.
Okay. Because?
Because I deal with predominantly white students. Okay. And they're not all white. Some of them are
in Dallas.
So that's why I haven't brought it up, and I thought that was something that maybe we should not talk. Maybe I should not be the leader of that conversation.
Fair enough, and I think you know what you shouldn't be, and you shouldn't have to be. White people should, right? And so this is the point. That's what we're doing within Move to Men, and I think that it's starting to pay off. That's all.
And his question speaks to a call to action by the white folks.
The white
privilege.
I think that's exactly right. So we have a stat. I'm going to finish the stat, then we'll do another one. I want to respect whoever was number 7.
That was me.
Yes, sir.
Wow. The conversation's gone kind of every which way since 1 to 6. You know, David, I've known you for 12, 15. Somewhere around like that.
For a minute.
And so I've been familiar with this curriculum for a while. I actually did lectures at TCU on this curriculum to college students that were studying government and political science about relating it specifically to Texas and the potential that Texas has in setting national priorities. Uh-huh. Texas has a long history of being rebellious, of being iconoclastic. It had integrated unions at one point that organized an entire platform that became the Progressive Party platform that was adopted everywhere else in the country except Texas. So, you know, we were talking about these intersectionalities of race, class, sex, gender. It is the fundamental work. It is why there are so few people of color here. It's why there are so few young people here, because young people are intolerant of their elders, rightfully so. And, you know, I just participated in a, you know, almost a year-long campaign against the Keystone XL pipeline in East Texas, where all of these same conversations were happening. On the front lines, we had young people from all over the country wanting to come to Texas because they see Texas as the capital of the petrochemical empire running the Western Hemisphere today. And they want to do something about it. Houston is the, and Dallas here with ExxonMobil, we're looking at the heart that's pumping the vast majority of petrochemical blood into our backyards, into our air, and it's forcing the suffering, the massive suffering there. And what I'm saying is that we here should be looking towards a capacity to invite our young people from all across the country to come to Texas to engage in these fights with us, because it's going to be hard to draw from our own communities because of the histories that we have here. And we have to set an example to what's going on in the political discourse within the I'm talking specifically within the progressive community, because there's already movements of color in Texas that are going to sweep changes here before we know it. And I, like David said, I welcome these changes, but they're going to come as a shock. And we need to be prepared to roll with those punches gracefully and set an example of what a just transition to an equitable society looks like to the rest of the world. Texas is one of the largest economies in the world. We owe it to the rest of the world to take on this responsibility seriously and to tackle these conversations in a serious, mature manner and not make light of the fact that there are so few young people represented here, but also generally politically educated and given the tools that we have here to think about these things in lofty terms. I mean, It's great to talk philosophy, and I love it. It's been my main organizing tool, is to be able to transcend the differences that I was raised with, to, you know, that told, I was told to stay out of certain circles, to stay out of certain organizing mentalities, to avoid certain sides of town. You know, I was raised in Arlington. So just to get off my pedestal.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So you say that in order to make the movement effective, we're going to bring people from outside, because I've spent the last few months trying to get anyone interested of my age.
Post-genocidal society, we live in a highly segregated society in Texas. These are not aspects of, like, intellectuality. These are real-life traumas that all of us live in, are stewed in all day long of our existence. We are traumatized by not knowing ourselves, not knowing the people around us, not knowing the land that we are here. How did we get here? It wasn't but a few generations ago that it was a completely different situation. The trauma that we inflict on the land is the trauma that we inflict on each other, is the trauma that we inflict on the rest of the world. And yeah, I do think that we're a sick society and we should be looking for outside help. And I think that a lot of that, and how to think about that is, you know, someone who invited a lot of outside help and actually received it, surprisingly. You know, I was surprised that people came from all over the country to help in Texas, in East Texas nonetheless, where, you know, I was told by my neighbors, don't go out there. Especially don't talk about overthrowing the government in East Texas. You're liable to make the wrong kind of company. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you what, it was the gun people. And that's probably the one mistake. If I were to say one thing that we did wrong, it was not letting the local NRA chapter show up to our protests armed. If we're serious about tackling this government, we have to be serious about the people that we want on our side, and that's people. It's not ideas. We don't need ideas. We don't need purity tests. We need people, and we need all kinds of people. And yeah, I'm just saying, there are people all over this country that are looking for leadership in Texas, and it's here if we can make the space for it, but it's not going to look like the leadership that we have. I mean, it's not going to look like David. I love David.
Nothing personal, David.
Yeah, nothing personal at all.
I take that personally.
So, let's just make those spaces. And a lot of it is just conversation, is all I'm saying. I encourage people to move to amends, encouraging its members to do. And consider to think critically about making accessible spaces and moving into partnership and coalition and having these conversations about historical trauma, historical privilege.